Good evening, professionals. We are in the fifth corporate law webinar series on how to wind up a company. Just to quickly summarize on where we are in terms of winding up of a company, we have been discussing the statutory provisions in Chapter 20 of the Companies Act, in which we discussed Section 270 to 285 of the Companies Act. In Part 1, we discussed how to strike off the company from the register, the charging provision being Section 248 of the Companies Act. Thereafter, we have been discussing Chapter 20, which deals with winding up, where in Part 2, we discussed about the winding up circumstances in which a company may be wound up, petition for winding up, and how a company liquidator is getting appointed, the terms and conditions of his appointment, his remuneration, when he will be removed, his independence in the affairs to be dealt with in the case of winding up. Then we discussed about in Part 3, the advisory committee, its roles, meeting of creditors, contributories, where we discuss section after 270 to 285. In Part 2, we discussed 287 to 294 in Part 3, and thereafter we discussed the voluntary winding up of company, where there is a transition shift from Companies Act to IBC, Insolvency and Bankruptcy Code, in the previous webinar, which is Part 3. And today we are going to deal with the debts and claims in the case of winding up of a company in Part 4. So where the provisions which we will be dealing with in Chapter 20 winding up are 324 to 332, read with relevant rules. As discussed in all the winding up sessions, friends, please remember the rules are yet to be notified. The rules are with effect from 1st April 2020, however, yet to be notified. So with this brief background, we will get into the winding up provisions Part 4. I sincere thanks to Mr. Sundarajan for this detailed presentation. So today we will be seeing, more importantly, CL in several slides, which is company liquidator. So we have discussed who is a company liquidator in our previous webinars. The company liquidator could be provisional liquidator, or if the powers are the same, then he is the company liquidator. IDEA is Industrial Disputes Act 1947. The reference is drawn with respect to workmen's dues and where the priority claims are being discussed with regard to debts and claims against the company. Registrar is ROC. No doubt, registry is the registry of tribunal or any of its benches of appellate tribunal, and tribunal for this purpose is NCLT. Today's outline will be more to deal with debts and claims against a company. Overriding preferential payments, what are they? The preferential payments, the components to it, other rules on debts and claims. So the debts and claims we will be primarily dealing with section 324, the charging section, and all the relevant rules starting from rule 100 will be discussed in other rules on debts and claims against the company. And what is a fraudulent preference? We will be dealing with the relevant section, transfers not in good faith, which will be construed as void, and what are those transfers, and certain transfers which will be construed as void, what are those? Liabilities and rights of persons who are having fraudulent preference, effect of floating charge. So we will conclude with section 332. The most important provision, debts and claims against the company. Debts of all descriptions to be admitted to proof. So section 324 says, in every winding up, all debts and all claims shall be admissible to proof. So there shall be a proof with regard to A, debts, B, claims against the company. So these debts could be either certain or contingent. Certain means there is no doubt because you have enough proof, which is conclusive. Contingent. Contingent is upon happening of an event, ascertained. The terms are very clear. Or sounding only in damages. What are those professionals? So a claim which is sounding only in damage could be only in the event of damage, like you're trespassing or you're breaching some of the covenants in the agreement. Covenants are nothing but the conditions to an agreement. Then these claims will be only in the event of such damages occurring. So, which is again not certain. So, these are admissible to proof against the company. And of course, when it comes to ambiguity with regard to contingent claims or sounding only in damage, a just estimate may be made or for some other reason may not bear a certain value. So, which are not certain, you may have to provide a just estimate. So, these are the descriptions of those debts which are admitted to proof. Rule 100 talks about notice for proving debts. Again, this is one of the important provisions where the timeline is prescribed and the mode in which the notice for proving debt is required to be provided by the companies which are getting wound up. CL, company liquidator, in the case of winding up, when shall he provide this notice? Within a period of 30 days from the date of order of winding up. Fix a day and give a notice of 14 days thereof. So, in order to prove your debt, a 14 days timeline is being given. And he is required to provide this notice by way of an advertisement within 30 days from the date of order of winding up. And the mode of notices by way of advertisement in two languages like any other rule, one in English language and one in the daily newspaper in the regional language, which is getting widely circulated in the state or union territory in which the registered office of the company is situated. And it is to whom? It is the addressee is the creditors of the company who shall prove their debts or claims. And what are they supposed to do? They shall establish their title to the claim which they are going to make. Under the priority claims are as provided in 326, 327, friends, which we'll be seeing in the subsequent slides. And to be excluded, what are to be excluded? From the benefit of distribution made before such debt or claim, or as the case may be, from objecting to such distribution. So here, the proof shall be, as in the case of any other notice or statement of affairs where it shall be backed by an affidavit, this proof of debt shall also be accompanied by an affidavit. And the form as prescribed in Rule 100 is Win 44, and it shall be delivered or sent to company liquidator by such mode as set out in Section 20 of the Companies Act, where Section 20 deals with the service of documents, the mode of service of documents, how it will be deemed to be delivered to the company or any officer of the company. In such mode, such notice shall be served. 326 deals with overriding preferential payments. You friends, please remember we dealt with 324 dealing with description, debt of all descriptions to be admitted in proof. Thereafter, we are going to deal with 326 overriding preferential payment. Reason being 325 is omitted because in Part-3 also we discussed that couple of provisions are omitted because they are shifted to IBC, Insolvency and Bankruptcy Code, and hence. Overriding preferential payments, section 326. In the winding up, the following debts shall be paid in priority to all other debts. 1. Workmen's dues. 2. Where a secured creditor has realized a secured asset. So much of the debts due to him which could not be realized by him, or amount of workmen's portion in his security. So in the secured creditor's debt, if there is such a portion of workmen's dues which is in the form of security, whichever is less, pari passu with this workmen's dues. So it shall be treated with equal right as workmen's dues with regard to secured creditor's claims. And who is a workman is as defined in section 2 subsection S of Industrial Disputes Act. So any person who is doing any manual, unskilled, skilled work, whether the terms of employment are express or implied, and he is for the purpose of proceedings under IDA in relation to any industrial dispute, includes any person who has been either dismissed, discharged or retrenched in connection with any industrial dispute, or his dismissal or discharge or retrenchment has led to such dispute. So such person shall be construed as a workman. And more importantly, such person shall be employed in any industry. But it does not include following persons who are subject to Air Force Act. So the employees who are subject to Air Force Act, Army Act or Navy Act will not come within this ambit, or those who are employed in the police service or as an officer or employee of a prison will not come, who's employed in managerial or administrative capacity will not be part of this workman definition, and who draws wages exceeding 10,000 and his functions are mainly of managerial nature. In such case, this person will not be considered as a workman. And what are workman's dues? Which will assume this preferential payment. This workman dues will be the aggregate of the following components. A, no doubt the wages and salaries which are accrued to him, and the compensation which is payable to any workman under the provisions of Industrial Disputes Act, and the leave salary, which is that accrued holiday remuneration which is payable to the workman, or in the event of his death to his legal heirs with regard to termination of employment before or by the effect of winding up order or resolution as the case may be. And unless the company is being wound up voluntarily merely for the purpose of reconstruction or amalgamation, or unless the company has at the commencement of winding up under such a contract with insurers as is mentioned in Workmen's Compensation Act. So with regard to any compensation which is required to be payable in respect of death or disablement of any workman, or any fund which is attributable to the welfare of such workmen, like pension fund, provident fund, gratuity fund. So all these sum shall be aggregated together to constitute this workman's dues. And workman's portion for this purpose shall mean amount which bears to the value of the security in same proportion as the amount of workman's dues which bears to the aggregate amount of workman's dues and amount of debt due to the secured creditors. So we can understand this particular definition of section 326 with an illustration, friends. So workman's portion, what does it comprise? In relation to security of any secured creditor, suppose the security of secured creditor is an aggregate value of 1 lakh. Means the amount which bears to the value of security, the same proportion. So the workman's compensation, the dues, all aggregate of all the components in point number 2 as mentioned above, if it attributes to 1 lakh, and the amount of debt due to secured creditors is 3 lakhs. So 1 lakh plus 3 lakhs, 4 lakhs. And the value of secured assets, however, is only 1 lakh. So the same proportion, which means he will have his contribution to the extent of 4 lakhs to the extent of 1:4. So 25% of this amount, he will have his entitlement over the total secured assets to the extent of 1 lakh. The workman's dues, rule 104 says, if there are numerous claims, each person need not lodge his separate proof with regard to the claim. There could be a consolidated submission of proof. So in any case where there are numerous claims, it shall be sufficient if there is one proof provided in Win 45 for all claims, and it shall comprise the name of each workman together with the proof of what is due to him. So the name of workman together with the amount which is due to each workman shall be provided in order to provide the claim. What are the preferential payments? Very important provision, friends. Section 327. So in a winding up, subject to the provisions of 326. So subject to workman dues and the secured creditors payment, whatever is referred in section 326. So subject to this provision, there shall be paid priority payments to all other debts in the following manner. So A talks about all the payments to the government or any local authority. So revenue, tax, the income tax, municipal tax to be paid. So everything will form part of your category A. So all revenue, taxes, cesses from the company to central government or state government or local authority. And having become due and payable, the timeline is clearly indicated, friends. It is within 12 months immediately before that date. 2 is your Salary payment. So all wages, salary payable, whether it is for time or piece work, whether it is in whole or in part. And again, the timeline here is, in respect of services rendered to the company for a period not exceeding 4 months within the 12 months immediately preceding the relevant date. So what is relevant date? Again, the explanation to section 327 talks about relevant date as the date of appointment or first appointment of the provisional liquidator, or if no such appointment is made, the date of winding up order as the case may be. And third one is your accrued holiday remuneration. Again, as mentioned in 326, it is either to the workman or in the event of his death to the legal heirs. And fourth payment is, unless the company is being wound up voluntarily by virtue of an amalgamation or reconstruction, any compensation which is payable by the employer under ESI Act 1948. Category 5E is the company which shall make any payment in the event of death or disablement of any employee of the company. And category F is all your funds which are for the benefit of the workmen, which is the pension fund, provident fund, gratuity fund. Or G is in respect of the expenses with regard to investigation in the affairs of the company under section 213 or 216, as the case may be. And any remuneration in respect of the period of holiday or absence from work on account of medical grounds for sickness shall also be deemed to be wages for this purpose. And where any payment has been made to any employee on account of wages or salary or accrued holiday remuneration, or in case of his death, out of money advanced by some person for that purpose, the person by whom it is advanced. So he shall, for example, the company does not have enough money to make this payment and somebody has advanced money. So he shall also rank in this particular list of preferential payments. So he shall be paid up to the amount to which the sum in respect of which this employee's dues are being settled therewith. And the debts enumerated in section 327 with regard to preferential payments shall rank equally. And if there is insufficiency of funds, then it shall be abated in equal proportion. So if the settlement is in the same ratio and there are sufficient funds, they will be paid to the extent of their claim. And if it is the funds are insufficient, then they will be paid in equal proportion. An employee for this purpose does not include a workman. And subject to retention of such sum as may be necessary for the winding up costs, the debts shall be discharged forthwith, because they are already proved under section 324 of this act together with the notice which is being submitted. And in case of debts to which priority is given under 327(1)(d), so in 327(1)(d) we discussed about that ESI compensation, so the any compensation, sorry, workman's compensation under section 14, so that assumes priority. In case of debts to which priority is given under 327(1)(d), there is no formal proof which is required to be submitted. And in the event of a landlord or person distraining or having distraint on any goods or effects of the company within 3 months before the date of this winding up order, the debts to which priority is given shall be first charged on the goods so distrained or on the proceeds of the sale thereof. However, in respect of money paid under any such charge, the landlord shall have the same rate of priority. So similar to this person who has advanced money in the case of priority payments, no, the landlord will also assume similar right with regard to preferential payments. So we discussed about the section which deals with debts and claims. Now we will see the rules governing the same. So rule 105 talks about production of bills of exchange and promissory notes. So the creditor shall produce the necessary negotiable instruments before the company liquidator, and it will be marked as the proof which is being admitted as conclusive evidence, friends. Value of debts, the value of debts and claims against the company be estimated according to the value thereof at the date of appointment of provisional liquidator or on the order of winding up date, whichever is earlier. And discount, a creditor shall all can also deduct all the trade discounts while submitting his proof of debt or claim. On interest, rule 108 says if there is no specific contract providing for interest, so it shall be not exceeding 6% for his claim from the due date till the date when the sum is being paid. Periodical payments, so in the case of lease rental where there is a rental payment or electricity, so all such periodical payments to be made by the company which are due at the time as referred to in 108, so which is becoming due and the order or resolution to wind up is already made for this company, the person who is liable to make the payment shall do. The company shall make the necessary payment to this landlord if it is in the form of rent or electricity, means he has to pay to the concerned authority. So the where the company liquidator remains in occupation of the premises which is being wound up, nothing shall prejudice or affect the right of the landlord to claim payment from the company for the rent of the place where it is occupied by the company liquidator or the company as the case may be. So with regard to debt which is a future claim, in that case a creditor may prove for any debt which is payable at the date of winding up as if it were payable presently and may receive dividend equally with other creditor. So it gives right to the creditor for future time payments and deduct, but there he could also deduct the rebate of interest at the rate of 6%, which was as provided in rule 108. And examination of proof, no doubt immediately on receipt of these documents with regard to proof of debt and claim against the company, the OL or CL in this case shall within such time as may be allowed by the tribunal examine these documents, every proof of debt, and he may call for production of any document, additional documentary proof if required from the creditors, or he may call them to be present in admission for the evidence to be submitted, and the creditors shall render necessary support to do so, and for making them to provide such documents in person as evidence, he shall send a notice to the creditor in Win 46, and the mode is also prescribed so as to reach him not later than 7 days, at least 7 days before the date fixed for this particular examination, he shall send this notice inviting the creditor to participate. Company liquidator's right to call any person in connection with investigation, rule 112. CL may call upon any person whom he may deem capable of giving information with regard to the debts to be proved, and he may require them to provide additional documents like how he calls for examination of proof from the creditor and affidavit. So for the purpose of his duties in relation to admission of proof, CL may take affidavits, and in certain cases he may also waive the requirement, and creditor shall no doubt bear the cost of proving his debt. After submission of proof, what happens? The company liquidator has to either accept or reject. So whenever he accepts, the notice of admission of proof shall be in form Win 48, and when he rejects, the ground of rejection as to why this particular claim of a creditor is not getting admitted into the records for priority claims shall be provided to this creditor, and such creditor could make an appeal to the tribunal not later than 21 days from the date of receipt of this particular notice of rejection of this claim. Procedure where creditor makes an appeal. So rule 117 says upon receipt of this particular decision, the CL makes a decision about rejecting a claim, he could forward this particular proof of why he has rejected to the registry. So registry is again your tribunal, NCLT's registry, with such proof, with the order containing the grounds of rejection very importantly. And she, for this purpose, when he is rejecting, he shall in no case be personally liable in relation to any appeal which is being made by the creditor questioning his decision about rejecting this particular claim. Proof and list of creditors. Having accepted the creditor's proof, he shall file the same with the names of creditors and the amount due to each creditor respectively to the tribunal, and the form is form win 50. List of creditors not to be varied. Rule 120 says list of creditors and shall be the list of creditors of the company. It shall not be added or varied except under the order of tribunal. The notice of filing list. Upon filing of the list of creditors, the registry shall immediately notify. So the CL will make this particular notification about which are the claims which are being accepted on records, and thereafter CL shall file it with the registry, and registry shall display it immediately on tribunal NCLT's notice board. And any creditor who wants to inspect the same has the authority to do so by making a payment of rupees 1000. And rule 122 talks about expunging of proof. If after admission CL has reason to believe that some proof has been improperly admitted or by mistake it is admitted, he may immediately make an application to tribunal to expunge that proof. Any creditor may also do so within 10 days from the date of admission. So he makes a claim and he finds that to be not in order, so he could immediately make an application to the tribunal within 10 days. Procedure on failure to prove debt within the time fixed, rule 123. What if the creditor does not honor this particular requirement of submission of proof? Still he has a recourse. He may make an appeal to the tribunal within 15 days from the date specified in the advertisement, and the tribunal may adjudicate upon the debt or direct the liquidator to take necessary steps. Right of creditor who has not proved his debt before declaration of dividend. So what happens in that case? Rule 124 says, so if he has not proved his debt before declaration of any dividend, he shall be entitled to be paid out of the money which is lying in the hands of CL, which is available for distribution of dividend. But what if he provides the proof after this particular dividend is being declared, in which case it will be adjusted against the future dividends only and not in the existing dividend. So payment of subsequent interest, rule 125 says, in the event of there being any surplus after paying in full the debts or claims which are adjusted against the proof which is being submitted, the creditors whose proofs have been admitted shall be paid interest at the rate of 6% or such other rate as may be decided by the tribunal. After making necessary adjustments against the said amount against the dividend declared as on the date of declaration of dividend. This is again important provision, friends. Fraudulent preference. So where a company gives preference to creditors or surety or guarantor with regard to any debts or claims, what happens? The company does anything or suffers anything done which has the effect of putting that person into the same position as if he has not submitted this particular thing. So which in the event of the company going into liquidation will be better than the position he would have been if that thing had not been made prior to 6 months before the winding up. So on the tribunal is satisfied that such transaction is a fraudulent preference, then the tribunal may ask for restoring the position which he would have been if the company had not given the preference. So if the company has given such fraudulent preference to any creditor or surety or guarantor, the tribunal has authority and right to put him in back to his original position in which he would have been had this fraudulent preference not occurred. And the tribunal, if it is satisfied that there is a preference transfer of mobile or immobile property or any delivery of goods to this particular person, it shall order for making such transaction invalid, considering the same to be of fraudulent preference, and restore the position to the original form. And 329-330 deals with transfers which are construed to be void. What are they? Any transfer of mobile or immobile property or delivery of goods made, they are excluding three such transactions, friends, which will not be considered as void. They are transfers which are made in the ordinary course of business or in favor of a purchaser or encumbrancer, which is made in utmost good faith, uberima fidei, and for valuable consideration. And if it is made, so excluding these three, if any such transfer is made, when? Within a period of 1 year before this presentation of petition for winding up, that transfer will be considered void by the tribunal against the company liquidator. And any transfer of assignment, transfer or assignment of properties to any trust for the benefit of creditors shall also be considered void. Section 331 deals with liabilities and rights of certain persons who have fraudulently preferred their debts or claims against the company. So where a company is being wound up and anything made, taken or done after the commencement of the act is invalid because fraudulent preference under 328 clearly says so. So without prejudice to the rights or liabilities which are arising from this provision, the person who has preferred, who has made such fraudulent preference, shall have the same rights as if he had undertaken to be personally liable for the debt to the extent of the mortgage or charge on the property or value of interest, whichever is less. Effect of floating charge is as dealt with in section 332 of the Companies Act. So where a company is being wound up and there is a floating charge which is created on the property of the company and which is created within 12 months immediately before the commencement of winding up, then unless it is proved that the company was solvent at that time, such floating charge which is created will be considered as invalid, except for the amount of any cash which is paid to the company subsequent to the creation of this particular floating charge and in consideration for the charge together with interest which will be paid at the rate of 5% or such other rate as may be notified by central government in this regard. So any floating charge which was created prior to this winding up within 12 months, then unless it is proved that the company was solvent at the time of creation of floating charge, it will be construed as invalid. Any questions with regard to section 324 to 332, friends? I'll be happy to take. So today we discussed about the debts and claims against the company, where we discussed overriding preferential payments with regard to workmen's dues, secured creditors payments, 324, 326, and preferential payments, the priority claims, which will assume the rank, where we discussed in detail about the workmen's dues, the wages, salaries, and then we discussed about 328, the fraudulent preference, and which are the transfers which will be construed as void under 329, 330, and what will happen to the liabilities and rights of the creditors or guarantors or surety who have fraudulently preferred their debts or claims, and floating charge unless the company was solvent prior to the winding up, which will be construed as invalid. So with this, we will conclude this part 4 of the winding up, friends. Thank you very much.